Let's talk about Israel. You're Jewish. You have been to Israel. You are very educated on the entire conflict. Right now, there seems to be one of two extremes. The one extreme, we're seeing folks in on one extreme that, hey, we just always stand with the oppressed, and Palestine is the oppressed, and therefore we just need to stand with the oppressed, regardless on Hamas and what's going on with the, some of the terrorist stuff in there. And then the other side is saying, you know, hey, we always need to stay with Israel no matter what. Israel is God's chosen people. We stand with Israel even if and even when Israel misbehaves. Before I get you your thoughts on this, because I really want to hear your thoughts. Guys, if you're enjoying this video, give it a like. This has been just bomb after bomb drop, and make sure that you're subscribed here with the bell notification on, and make sure you're also subscribed to Ask Dr. Brown's channel, which is pinned up in the title and in the description of this video. So Israel, Hamas, Palestine, this entire conflict goes back at least 100 years after the Ottoman Empire fell, but it goes before that. Break it down from your perspective on this.
Yeah, so I'll give the short version. This may have to be a lengthier conversation another day, but here are the things that I hold to be true. Number one, that God did scatter the Jewish people from the land under judgment, but in keeping with his promise, has regathered. That when God blesses, no one can curse. When he curses, no one can bless. When he opens the door, no one can shut it. When he shuts the door, no one can open it. When he scatters, no one can gather. So the reason that my people are back in the land is because God regathered us, not because of our goodness, but because of his goodness. Just as he said in Ezekiel 36, he's doing it for his name's sake, not because of our righteousness. He's bringing us back into the land unclean, and they're sprinkling clean water on us. So these are lasting covenants he made. Read Psalm 105, just as one example among many, that he promised this to Abraham's descendants in the plural. And Romans 15, Paul indicates that the Messiah does not cancel the promises to the patriarchs, but he confirms them. So the Jewish people are back in the land by the will of God, and therefore I absolutely affirm the modern state of Israel as of prophetic significance and according to the will of God. That's number one. Mm-hmm. Number two, I recognize the devil wants to destroy the Jewish people, wipe them out entirely, and keep them out of the land, and hence the constant controversy. I also see from Scripture that a Jewish Jerusalem must welcome the Messiah back, hence the battle over Jerusalem, and obviously the ultimate thing, keeping Jews away from Jesus. So number one, God brought the Jewish people back to the land, so I stand with God's activity there. Number two, Satan wants to wipe them out, drive them out of the land, so I stand against Satan's activity. Number three, through much of church history, the church has persecuted the Jewish people, has driven them out of countries because they wouldn't be baptized. Your average Jew, the more religious they are, the more they know their history, the more they think Christianity is an evil religion. The more they think there's a straight line from Jesus to the Holocaust. And one of the great ways for Christians to overcome the stain of blood on our history and the way that Jews have been driven away from Jesus by the church is to recognize, out of the ashes of the Holocaust, God restored the Jewish people back to the land. It's a modern miracle, and Christians should stand with the Jewish people in that regard, recognizing that they're surrounded by hateful enemies that want to destroy them. So Christian solidarity with Israel has gone a long way to removing the stench of the past. If folks have never read my book, Our Hands Are Stained with Blood, it's an eye-opener. It's like must reading for Christians about church history. And Christian love for Israel has really gone a long way to saying, hey, this is who we really are. I know you have, you know, Martin Luther's anti-Semitism and the Catholic Church's anti-Semitism, but this is who we really are. That being said, God cares for every human being, and God cares for Palestinians just as much as he cares for Jews.
Yeah.
And God wants fair treatment of all, and therefore, as friends of Israel, we should urge them to do their best to work peacefully and in the best interest of all parties in the land, including the Palestinians. So my heart is fundamentally standing with Israel while at the same time calling Israel to account where I differ. True friends differ. I have more differences with my wife, Nancy, than anyone. You know, she's more critical of me than any human being on the planet. And we're the best of friends for 45 years married, you know? Yeah. So as a friend of Israel, if I differ with Israel, I'm going to call Israel out. Now, on a historical level, there's a on my video channel, there's a lecture I did, Is Israel an Evil Occupier, that people find really helpful on the S. Dr. Brown YouTube channel. But in short, there was always a Jewish presence in the land for 2,000 years, even after we were exiled. There was always a Jewish presence there. Jerusalem was always the city to which Jews prayed. Every year at Passover, Jews would say, next year in Jerusalem. Jerusalem was the eternal capital of the Jewish people in that respect, and the one and only homeland for the Jewish people. So even while most of our people were in exile around the world, there was always the hope, the longing to be back in the land and to be back in Jerusalem, worshiping God there. And that was to be what the Messiah would do, you know, regather the exiles. Over the centuries, different ones controlled what would be called the Holy Land. The church, and then Islam took over, and then back and forth, and then ultimately Ottoman Empire, and then British Mandate, you know, after World War I, being given responsibility there. What happened was you had a predominantly Arab presence, a minority Jewish presence in the late 1800s. But as more and more Jews started to return to the land and cultivate the land, this provided better opportunities for the Arab farmers. So more and more Arabs moved into the area. So you have some that identify as Palestinian that have been there many, many centuries. Mm-hmm. Some maybe for 2,000 years, you know, back to the, some may have originally been Jews who lived there and then were forced to convert to Islam. Mm. So that's a very interesting little story about Palestinians with Jewish DNA.
Yeah.
But the great majority, the vast majority of those who identify as Palestinian today do not have a history of hundreds and hundreds of years. It began with the greater influx in the late 1800s, early 1900s, and pretty much both parties living side by side. Mm-hmm. Jewish landowners developing, you know, draining the swamps, different things, Arab workers coming in. So Arab majority, Jewish minority. That was the reality. What then happens is you have the Balfour Declaration that there would be a Jewish homeland.
Yep.
And then you begin to have the uprising against the Jews starting in the 1920s under Haji Amin al-Husseini, who became a confidant of Adolf Hitler. Some believe he was the one that suggested extermination. But in any case, you have the first intifadas, the slaughter of Jews and things like that. But in those days, the ones who identified as Palestinians were Jews. The Palestinian orchestra was Jewish. The newspaper we know as the Jerusalem Post was called the Palestine Post, and it was Jewish. The Arabs did not identify as Palestinians because there was no such thing as a Palestinian history. They were Arabs living in the land. They were part of Greater Syria. That was the larger identity, or part of Jordan. But they did not have that. Even statehood in the Middle East was not clearly defined until that time. It was more tribal. You know, things like Saudi Arabia as a state, these are just tribal regions otherwise with different groups. Okay, so anyway, in 1937, the Peel Commission presents an opportunity and says, okay, let's do this. We'll have Jerusalem and another stretch through the middle of the land under international and British control. Mm-hmm. The Arabs will get 75%. The Jews will get the remaining, 18%, something like that. There was great debate among the Jewish community, but leaders opting towards siding with it, but the Arabs unanimously say, no, this is our land. We're not making an agreement to live here with the Jews. So then 1947, the UN partition plan. Now this is much worse. The Jews get much less land this time around. Mm-hmm. The Jewish leadership accepts it. David Ben-Gurion, Golda Meir say, look, there's room for everyone. Let's live together as neighbors and friends. The Arab leadership says, we're going to wipe you out. We're going to drive you into the sea. Mm-hmm. So what happens is when Israel declares its independence in 1948, immediately 800,000 Jews in all the surrounding Muslim countries are forcefully exiled. Mm-hmm. They are kicked out of the countries.
Wow.
And the majority go to Israel. Others emigrate to different parts of the world. There are about 600,000, or say roughly 800,000 Arabs living in the land at that time. Mm-hmm. Because of the war, about 600,000 leave. Some flee for their own lives. Some are driven out by the Israeli army. And others listen to the Arab leadership who says, we're going to drive the Jews into the sea, then come back, take your land. About 200,000 stay. So what happens is that the 600,000 now become refugees because the Arab armies, five Arab armies attack, Muslim armies attack, and Israel miraculously wins. This fledgling little army, brand new nation, fresh out of the Holocaust, somehow survives. Mm-hmm. And now you have a refugee crisis. Who created it? The Arab leaders. Mm. They could have accepted the Peel Commission, boundaries and had a two-state solution in 37. They could have accepted in 47, 48. They didn't. Yeah. So now many of these make their way to Gaza. That's where a lot of the refugees are. The surrounding Arab nations, the Arab League in the 50s says, we will not accept Palestinian refugees. We'll not accept them.
Yeah.
So now you have the refugee problem that is constantly making Israel look bad.
Yeah.
And then the Six-Day War in 1967, Israel extends its boundaries in a safer way, etc. And ever since then, what's going to happen? What's the solution? Now, the big statement that remains true is, if the Palestinians, meaning the leaders, put down their weapons, there'd be no more war.
Yep.
If the Israelis put down their weapons, there'd be no more Israel.
Yep.
And the problem is, the Palestinian leadership is the great problem. The Israelis are going further and further to the right, and there's more extremism coming up and more Arab hatred coming up among some of the right-wing parties, but that's still the minority.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the leadership of Hamas, they are bent on destroying Israel, period.
Yep.
There cannot be a Jewish state. And you have to realize from the perspective of Islam, once something is under Islamic control, if it's taken back, that's an absolute affront. That would be like someone running off with your wife. And you know, how can that be?
Yeah.
So Hamas is a terrorist organization that wants to wipe Israel off the map.
Yeah.
And yet the leadership that was elected by the people of Gaza. So you grow up in Gaza Strip. The average age of people living in Gaza is about 18. A tremendous amount of young people.
Yeah.
You grow up living enclosed because Israel's had to blockade because of Hamas weapons and terrorism, right? You grew up under that. You grew up with massive unemployment, periodically bombed by Israel. So they're the enemy. They're the bad ones.
Yeah.
And Hamas are trying to fight these demons off. But the reality is it's bad leadership.
Yeah.
Same with Palestinian Authority. Not as bad as Hamas, but they've been in civil war for years. They had a bloody civil war in Gaza. And Mahmoud Abbas was elected many, many years ago. Whatever happened to the elections, they haven't happened since. So I believe that that if there could be leaders of the Palestinians who fully embrace the fact that there will be a Jewish state here in the Middle East, and that working together with this state and dwelling side by side in an honorable way is the best thing for it. I believe the majority of Israelis would want to make that happen.
Make a two-state solution, yeah.
Well, if it's, I mean, I don't know how. That's the bigger issue.
Yeah.
Two-state, you know, how does it work? Because the Palestinians said we don't want any Jews. If we have two-state, we don't want any Jews in our state.
Mm.
So that would mean all the settlers, hundreds of thousands of people, have to be kicked out. Mm. Others have said, you know, we won't have autonomy, etc. Others have advocated for one-state solution. The problem is that if the Palestinians have equal rights and equal voting opportunity, because they're about 70% of Israel is fairly secular, they have a very low birth rate. The religious Jews have a super high birth rate, as many as, you know, 12 plus kids a family.
Yeah.
I mean, unbelievably high birth rate. But on average, Palestinians, Muslims, have a high birth rate. And over time, they would then outnumber the Jews.
Yep.
So how do you have one state, which is now going to be, I was going to be a Jewish state if it's primarily Muslim?
So yeah.
I don't know the solution.
Sure.
But having spoken at a Palestinian conference, you know, an anti-Zionist conference where I was the one pro-Israel person that came in, and spent extensive time sitting with young people, listening, hearing people's stories, going to troubled places, hearing the narrative. Life is hard for them.
Yeah.
And the 200,000 Arabs who stayed within Israel, right? They're now over 1.5 million. They have one of the Supreme Court members. They have doctors and professors and lawyers and everything. And they have more freedoms than any other Arab basically in the Middle East. Ask them, would you like to be under Hamas or Palestinian Authority? I said, no, we'd rather be under the Israeli leadership, the great majority.
Yep.
So to me, the thing is, if you could get Palestinian leadership that truly said, we accept your presence here, there is enough room for all of us, like the other, you know, the other Arab nations with the Abraham Accords, they got fed up with the Palestinians. They said, let's just work together for economic prosperity for the region. You guys just keep refusing what's being offered to you. I believe if that happened and Israelis were really convinced of their safety, that things would really change. So last point, so much for a short answer. Sorry.
It's okay. I love it. This is great.
So, okay. There is a security fence that now runs through Israel and even separates neighborhoods, you know, of the Palestinians. And then in parts, it's actually a wall. So you would have the impression that there's this monstrous wall running through Israel that was built. Actually, over 95% of it is fence. Less than 5% is wall. And they put up walls where there were snipers, and this was to keep snipers out. But the wall, I watched this video where the designer of the wall talks about the hole of hope, that where you do have the wall, there's a hole on top for the day when they can dismantle it. They lift it up by that and dismantle it. Nobody wants the fence. When I say nobody, the vast majority of people on each side don't want it. But Israel put it up to keep murderers out. It's that simple. That's the primary reason for it. Hamas is indiscriminately trying to murder Israelis. When Israel goes to war with Hamas, they send warnings. They call families, get out. We're about to bomb this place because of terrorist activity. Please leave. Get your children out. So you've got two different mentalities. And I think it was Golda Meir said that when you started, what was the exact saying? Something about loving your children more than you hate ours. We can have peace. You know, when you're concerned about your kids' future. Now, ultimately, I don't think there'll be total peace until Jesus comes.
Yeah.
But I do believe there are better ways. I believe Israel can move in certain ways to help the Palestinians, but it's all a matter of getting rid of the corrupt leadership and having people that really are serious about the betterment of all peoples living there.
It sounds like the root of the issue goes down to Israel's right to exist as a nation. And it could be, if we could pinpoint it to something, it could be pinpointed to that. And Israel, because of the history of the Holocaust, because of all the oppression the Jewish people have experienced, it's almost like, hey, you're going to say we don't have a right to exist. You're going to say that, you know, and now it's like the scrawny kid that got really buff and was bullied is now, he's got muscles and he can turn up and he can be kind of rough if he needs to be. And then people are like, wait, confused, but not understanding the history of all this stuff. And a lot of this is honestly a mess made by 1915 and that British treaty and all the confusion with that and then kind of being dumped into the UN's lap. And it just seems like it's just a multi-layered mess. And so I appreciate what you're saying. I think that sounds like the heart of it. Does Israel have a right to exist as a nation? Yes. Great. Get some leadership that say that, and then it can get better for the Palestinian people. Unfortunately, the Hamas, it seems like, are doing really calculated PR to keep a lot of the Palestinians on their side, and it just complicates things even more.
Yeah, so just to weigh in on that briefly, Hamas leadership has really done well now to present themselves as the keepers of Jerusalem and the holy sites and the defenders of the people. And this is in the ongoing war to try to win the hearts of the people. And remember, before 67, they weren't called Palestinians. This called, you know, Arabs or whatever background they had from different nations. But the crisis has been precipitated for Hamas. The more, tragically, the more dead Palestinians, the better, because it's better for international PR. It makes Israel look bad. Look at the rise of anti-Semitism around the world, all the Jew hatred. People say, oh, no, anti-Semitism is not anti-Zionism is not anti-Semitism. It's like, well, then you tell me why the wrath is not just on Israel, why Jews on the streets are getting attacked all around the world.
Yeah, just so, in New York a couple of weeks ago, yeah.
Yeah, the connection is very deep between the two, for sure, in most cases. But that being said, Hamas now is like the freedom fighters and the defenders of the people, and they're vying for more control. You know, the West Bank is under so-called West Bank under the control of Palestinian Authority, but Hamas would like more authority and more control. And for so many of the Arabs living there, Hamas, they're the good guys, and they're helping us against the bad guys, Israel. The only positive to take away from this is that there are younger people who, because of social media, even though there are restrictions under Hamas and things like that, you know, have state-run TV and same with Palestinian Authority, that just a lot of younger people are saying there's got to be a better way. You know, many of them raised, especially in the Palestinian schools, with real hostility towards Israel. Think of, you know, you go into a kindergarten that's named after a terrorist. You know, that is the culture. And then the Christians among them are a tiny, tiny minority. But Yeah, it's one of those things where younger people have had it with the way things are. Within Israel, there's tremendous amount of self-criticism. You know, you have Israeli professors calling for boycotts of Israel. You have Haaretz, which is another historic publication in Israel. And many of their editorials are written by Muslims, Palestinians that are hostile to the state and things like that. So Israel is very self-critical. And the extremism to the right is still minority. So I believe that that your average person, you know, you think Israel enjoys having all of their kids have to serve in the military and spend so much military budget just to keep safe. Mm. And then think every single house in Israel must have a bomb shelter. If you live in an apartment building, there must be X number of bomb shelters for the people. If you live in Sderot, which is, you know, bordering Gaza, wherever you are, you must be no more than 15 seconds from a bomb shelter. Whether you're in the shower, whether you're in the playground, 15 seconds.
Wow.
And you got little kids there that suffering from PTSD because of all the bombing. Yeah. And then God knows the suffering of the people in Gaza and what they've lived through and the hardships they've experienced. So, you know, your average person, if you can get past, you know, the Islamic religious issue and the historic hatred of Jews and the Jewish hostility towards Palestinians for their murderous ways, etc., I think most people want to live side by side peacefully, and they've had it with the wars and the terrorism.
Yeah.
And that may lead to something better, but, you know, it's very complex, deep, religious, historic, national.
Yeah. Yeah.
And we are mandated to pray, though, for the peace of Jerusalem in Psalm 122 and Isaiah 62. I pray that Jerusalem will be the praise of all the earth, and don't stop asking God until he does that.
Amen. Dr. Michael Brown, this has been incredible. Guys, if you found this valuable, make sure you go subscribe to Dr. Michael Brown's channel. It's in the description. Give this video a like. Make sure you're subscribed here, all that good stuff. Dr. Michael Brown, I'm going to give you the final word. A lot of people watching, what would you like to leave us with? We covered a lot of topics, so final word for everybody watching here.
All right, three final words. Number one, wherever you stand theologically, just go after God. Make your life count. Pursue everything he has and make your life count to reach a lost and dying world. That's number one. Number two, visit my website, askdrbrown.org. We've got tons of resources. Sign up for my emails while you're there. We share a lot more stuff via email. So askdrbrown.org. And with that, you can connect with me on social media anywhere. And then number three, the reason in the midst of a kind of crazy busy schedule that I'm on this broadcast is because I like this guy. So I've only got to tell you a little bit through the broadcast, but I like you. I appreciate you, man. So we're in this together, buddy.
Thank you so much, Dr. Michael Brown. Guys, there you have it. Make sure you subscribe, liked all that kind of stuff, and send Dr. Michael Brown some love in his comments and on his Twitter. He responds to a lot of his tweets. So Dr. Michael Brown, thank you so much. This was incredible. Probably my favorite stream yet. So thank you so much.
Awesome. God bless you, man. Thank you.
God bless you. Yahshua the King came down and bore it all. Yeah, conversations front of the fireplace. All of my mistakes, how do I erase? Wanna operate at a higher pace. Birth pains causing the body to dilate. On a first name basis with the worst pain facing. Moments in isolation. See, I was hoping I